There was a fungus among us. There was a rumble in the jungle. There was a static in the attic, a moaning and a groaning, a fungus among us. We had a fight in the middle of the night. There was a fungus among us.
Which one is the fungus?
We were having a party the other night. Somebody got mad and they started to fight. I couldn't understand what it caused at all, but nevertheless, we were having a ball. There was a fungus among us.
Which one is the fungus?
There was a fungus among us.
Which one is the fungus?
There was a cruising for the bruising.
It's Dr. Ed Park from Lokahi Guru, and we're very privileged to be talking to Dr. Joe Brewer, who is also a speaker here at the A4M show. Dr. Brewer is the head of Plaza Infectious Diseases in Kansas City, Missouri. He's an infectious disease specialist and a medical doctor, and he has carved out an interesting niche in the area of yeast and mold infections. So let's get to know Dr. Brewer. Dr. Brewer, thank you for joining us.
Glad to be here.
Great. So we were discussing the issue of your interest is in mold, black mold particularly, but there are other types of mold as well. In my practice, I have people who come to me with these symptoms largely because they've gone through the system. It's very difficult to diagnose a protean disease. Proteus was the god of change, and so it means a disease that presents with many number of symptoms. A good example would be lupus, is a very protean disease. But yeast infection or mold, and we'll get into the difference, can present with many non-specific symptoms, and it can often tax the psychiatrist, the psychologist, the family practitioner. They don't know what the heck's going on, so eventually they do their own literature search and they say, aha, if they land upon the constellation of symptoms, which includes everything, they'll say maybe it's this, and then they find Dr. Brewer. So, for example, aches, fatigue, difficulty sleeping, depression. Tell us what the typical presenting symptoms would be for a chronic mold infection.
Well, it would match pretty closely with the chronic fatigue syndrome, fibromyalgia type patient, and in above and beyond some things that you mentioned, like anxiety and depression and things like those. So the work we've done, we sort of set as a prototype the chronic fatigue syndrome patient and have studied those and found that all of the various symptoms, as you mentioned, fatigue, fibromyalgia type aching, brain fog is a common one with the cognitive dysfunction, even some varied neurological features, and then some of the psychological features, even irritable bowel syndrome, all can be associated with these patients.
Fascinating. So now, in medicine, we like to ask a question, get a history, and sometimes there'll be that thing that we call pathognomonic. That means it's a red flag that tells us, oh, this is going to be this disease. In Lyme disease, which also is a overlapping Venn diagram, we get a target lesion. But the problem with various infections with these critters is that there's nothing really pathognomonic, is there? Can you give a clinician an idea? Okay, a person is being treated for depression, or a person has sinusitis. What are some kind of soft signs that we might be dealing with, not just simple psychological problems or the classic disease of exclusion, chronic fatigue syndrome or fibromyalgia?
Well, the best is to screen with symptoms, and then with the ones that I just mentioned, and then with the mold cases, we found that screening for an exposure history, but it has to go way back. This cannot be a recent exposure history saying, have you been exposed in the last 1 to 2 years? The exposure could have been 25 years ago.
Are you saying that a person can harbor these infections for decades?
Yes.
Wow, that's really revolutionary. I mean, typically we think of the body as a host to trillions, I mean more than our cells, of bacteria, because they're small critters, and we know that there's yeast everywhere. If you don't keep dry and clean, you'll get yeast. But what we're talking about is pan-colonization in an unfriendly way across the lifespan. That's really scary.
And we're also talking about mold, which are related to yeast. Mold and yeast are both in the fungal grouping, but mold is different. Yeast we have on us normally and inside of our GI tract just in low numbers. But the molds basically are growing in materials in a sense that we look in the history is a building, usually a home or an apartment or a condominium or even a work building that has had water damage to it, and then there's become mold growth, and then the patient gets exposed.
So what we're really talking about is a person could be feeling crappy, the doctors don't know what's wrong, but what he's saying is if you're a good clinician, get a history. It's oftentimes people will peel back the carpet after grandma dies or whatever, and you'll see black mold everywhere. That's a good history. Tear down the drywall, guess what? It's not that dry behind the wall. So the red flag would be water damage. So that's a big one. And just from a building's perspective, how does a person even suspect that there might be? Is there a test I can buy that will say, oh, your house has mold?
They do sell some basic, relatively inexpensive mold kits, so to speak, at places like Home Depot and Lowe's. The more sophisticated, a person can look online or look in the yellow pages and look up for certified mold testing companies, and they should make sure they're certified.
Yeah.
And these are companies that are legitimate, and they can come in and do sampling in the house, inspection of the of the entire place, looking for prior water damage and the actual mold.
Yeah, that's really important. So, question, you know, one of our colleagues and friends is Suzanne Summers, and she had a home which was infested with black mold, and it really impacted her life. Luckily, she had other modalities to try and stay healthy. Another famous case, Johnny Carson's home infected with mold, but he, in the case of the rich getting richer, got like a $10 million settlement. Now, there's a financial issue with people finding mold, and there's a house insurance issue, and so it's very confusing to people. It's like, is this a jackpot in my house? If I'm sick and I got mold, is there some kind of lawsuit I can join to become a gazillionaire, or is it just the celebs that can do that? Who can sue for mold in their house?
Well, probably anyone could, but one of the issues that always comes up is the link of mold to illness, and what illness that it produces, and that's the area. What we've been doing is linking the toxin-producing molds, like the black molds and so forth, to illness, and in this situation, chronic illness. So the sequence of events is to first establish whether we think the illness is due to the mold, and if it is due to the mold, then that individual, if they're still living in the residence or working in the building in which the mold is present, they need to try to get away from it, whether it is to get out of the house or get it remediated or whatever, and then that eventually may lead to legal consequences.
Okay, but it's kind of case by case. It's not
correct.
A slam dunk.
I was shaking all over, didn't know what to do. The dog and the cat, they were fighting too. Then a real stink chick come over to me. She said,
cool it, Daddy. Can't you see?
There's a fungus among us.
Which one is the fungus?
There was a fungus among us.
Which one is the fungus?
There was a cruising for a bruising. There was a winning and a losing.